In this video, I am going to talk in details about the antibody levels found after vaccination with mRNA vaccine Pfizer BioNTech, Moderna, and I will do a comparison with viral vector vaccine Oxford AstraZeneca, Johnson & Johnson, Sputnik V, and inactivated vaccine Sinopharm. We will also see how antibody level went with time with these vaccines. The references are listed here and also in the description. There are various methods of quantifying the antibody levels. Different method gives different number. So I am not going to go into the absolute number. We will talk about the relative amount of antibody generated by each vaccine. This figure is very interesting. In this figure, the green color dots represent Pfizer-BioNTech. The purple color dots represent Moderna. Orange color dot represent Oxford-AstraZeneca. And blue color dots represent Johnson & Johnson vaccine. Pfizer, Moderna and AstraZeneca are two-dose vaccine, while Johnson & Johnson is a one-dose vaccine. Blood samples were collected 3 weeks after first dose and 4 weeks after the second dose. For Johnson & Johnson, which is a one-dose vaccine, blood samples were collected 5 and 8 weeks after the first dose. Now, each dot means antibody level for that particular sample. That is, each dot represents each person's antibody level. And the red lines represent the range of antibody level found for that particular vaccine. Now, if we plot antibody level in y-axis and vaccine type in x-axis, and let's consider a person has an antibody of 8, another person has an antibody of 4, another person has antibody 6, another person has antibody level 2, and another person has antibody level 4. So, this is the range. That is, different amount of antibody is produced by different person. Now, the average antibody level is 4.8, which is represented by a line. Here, the blue line represents the average antibody level. Now, let's go back to the figure. So, here you should concentrate in the bold black line. After first dose, that is post-prime, the antibody generated was less compared to after the second dose in all the three cases. In case of Johnson & Johnson, after 8 weeks, the antibody level was found to be more, which might be due to antibody maturation. Now, in all cases, Moderna had more antibody compared to the other three vaccines. The viral vector vaccines produced less antibody compared to the mRNA vaccines. mRNA vaccine had one order higher antibody compared to the viral vector vaccines. So, it seems that mRNA vaccines produce more antibody compared to the viral vector vaccines. Let's now compare between Sinopharm and Pfizer-BioNTech. Sinopharm is an inactivated vaccine. The numbers you will get here will be different from the previous one since the tests are done in a different way. It was found that 99.3% who received Pfizer developed antibody, while in case of Sinopharm, 85.7% developed antibody. And Pfizer produced more antibody compared to Sinopharm. These were after two doses of each vaccine given 21 days apart. So by now you know that mRNA vaccines produce more neutralizing antibody compared to viral vector and inactivated vaccines. In case of Sputnik V, the antibody level increased from first dose to second dose from hundreds to thousand. Let's now see how long the antibody stays. This study talks about the antibody kinetics of Pfizer-BioNTech, Moderna and Johnson & Johnson. They have performed different methods, but I will show one of such methods. The first line in each means antibody produced 2 to 4 weeks after second dose when the antibody is at the peak. The second line represents antibody produced 6 months after the second dose. And the third line represents antibody produced 8 months after the second dose. Remember, in case of Johnson & Johnson, these are after first dose. As you can see, Moderna had maximum antibody followed by Pfizer-BioNTech and least antibody was found in case of Johnson & Johnson. There was a decline in antibody in all three cases. However, in case of mRNA vaccine, the decline was drastic in the first 6 months and then it slowed down. In case of Johnson & Johnson, the decline was slower. In another study, the scientists did a comparison of the antibody level between Pfizer-BioNTech, the blue bar, and Oxford-AstraZeneca, the orange bar, 14 days to 70 days or more after the second dose. Although a mRNA vaccine had more antibody at the beginning, both showed decline in the antibody level. And according to this paper, in case of Pfizer-BioNTech, the level declined by 2-fold, while in case of Oxford-AstraZeneca, the level declined by 5-fold. Over 70-day period. In case of Sinopharm vaccine, the antibody level after first dose is 9.26. After second dose, it went high to 154. 2 weeks after second dose, the antibody reduced to 89 and it was found to decrease further to 69. They calculated an average fall of 1.66 BAU per ml per day. However, those who had third dose 3 to 4 months after second dose, they had an antibody level of 250. So it seems booster dose in case of Sinopharm works good in increasing the antibody level. It was found that 60% had high antibody level 1 month after second dose of CoronaVac compared to 86% had high antibody level 1 month after two doses of Oxford-AstraZeneca. Since CoronaVac and Sinopharm work in the same way, it is expected that the antibody level found with Sinopharm will be also same as CoronaVac, which is lesser than Oxford-AstraZeneca. Now we will see antibody waning of another viral vector vaccine, Sputnik V. Sputnik V is a viral vector vaccine, but it uses two different vectors in the first and second dose. There was an increase in the antibody level from first dose to second dose from hundreds to thousands, and then there was a decrease in 120 to 180 days, that is, after 4 to 6 months, there was a decrease in the antibody level. So, from all this data, we can see with second dose, antibody level increases and there is a decline in the antibody level as the time goes. However, head-to-head comparison will tell us how they are comparable to each other. There are certain conditions when antibody is produced less compared to other people. In case of male, antibody is produced less compared to female. Older people produce less antibody. Obesity produce less antibody. Diabetes produce less antibody. Immunosuppressive treatment produce less antibody. Cancer produce less antibody. And appearance of novel variants of concern also produce less antibody in people. We all know that CDC do not recommend antibody testing for everyone post-vaccination. However, in certain cases, testing of antibody over time might be helpful. In case of potential non-responders, like I have mentioned before, it's important to know if they have generated antibody. If not, booster might be required. However, it's not necessary for the young healthy people as 99% of us will generate antibody once vaccinated. Another thing to note is that people who had prior infection had more antibody when vaccinated compared to people without infection. However, most important thing is that we have to remember T and B memory cells, that is cellular immunity, play a very important role apart from antibodies. So waning of antibody does not mean we are not protected. Once infected, memory cells will wake up and do their job and kill the virus. Thus, we should not think only about antibodies. We should think about T and B cells as well. That's it for today, guys. If you found this video informative, don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe for more updates. Thank you.